What is it called?
The UW thing, like the Panopto for like creating the show.
Oh,
like
it's so bad right now.
It is QuickTime Pro.
Okay, no. It
just comes with. Records the screen. Which is pretty much what I wanted. But I haven't used it.
Hey, you can record a whole class. You can also create recordings from your laptop where it's a combined, like, you can have slides and it'll record you and the slides. So editing it.
That would be cool.
Disaster.
Okay. But doesn't it put your face in it?
What's your face?
Okay, that's kind of nice. So I guess it uses more CPU even. Okay.
It's free for us here. So I don't know how old it is once we make it.
Ah, well, that sounds like it's worth trying. Okay, so I wrote kind of a markdown talk sort of thing. And right now, SMC doesn't really have a good way of displaying markdown in a presentation in the format. Actually, I just realized there is one, so that's why it looks so ridiculous here. There should be one. There should be like a little button here, which is presentation, which one of you will implement, but it hasn't happened yet. So, but I just realized a good way to do this would be to make a Sage worksheet, put %MD at the top, do that, and then I can change the font and go like that. And it suddenly becomes more presentation friendly. I didn't say presentation friendly, just more presentation friendly. Stupid buttons are annoying.
Is there a way to
add this? Yes. Yes. Using the JavaScript editor. Yeah. Okay, so I'm just going to go through this and tell you some overview about what Sage Math Cloud is, where it comes from, and its architecture. Before that, though, since I don't know most of you, can just go around and introduce yourselves and stuff. Yeah.
I'm Cody.
Okay. Maybe say something about yourself. Like, I don't know. Didn't John suggest a kind of areas of stuff you might work on? Maybe you could say what he suggested, which may or may not be what you do. But.
Maybe. Okay. No, I'm Cody, and I work on documentation and content.
Cool. Okay, good. Awesome.
And that guy. My name is Varun. I am a TA for one of the computer science classes. I am probably going to be working on the React stuff.
Nice. Okay.
My name is Rebecca. I used to be a TA for one of the CS classes. And I think I'm working on the front end.
Cool.
I'm Rob. I am a math major and I am planning on working on data analytics.
Okay. Nice.
Okay, I'm Jonathan.
Are you guys here?
Yes, can you sort of?
He doesn't know you.
Oh, hi. I'm Jonathan. I'm an undergrad CS major. I've been kind of involved with Sage Math Cloud for like a year and a half during the summers mostly. And I kind of get there. That's me.
Cool.
I'm Nicholas. Got involved at the same time as Jonathan, more or less. Worked with him the last two summers as well.
I'm Andy. Worked on Sage not this past summer, but the one before. Probably be doing some kind of documentation, probably along with Cody.
I'm Ishan. I'm a sophomore, and I'll probably be working on databases.
Cool.
I'm Anirban. I'm a sophomore too. I'll probably be working maybe on the front end of the Linux.
Okay, nice.
I'm Jay Vatraya. I'm a new faculty member in here, and I'm using Sage Math Cloud.
He's also paying, I guess, or some part of your most recent timesheet, Nick, with his startup money.
We did a
so.
Subscription pack. We did a package for the course, so that it would be running on its.
But instead of him having to pay a company and the company, he's just directly paying your part of your timesheet. So that hasn't been paid yet. Did you get your checks, by the way, at the front? Okay, good. So it's just the last one. Okay, so that's everybody. And me, I'm William Stein. I started Sage, and I started Sage Math Cloud. And I've been a faculty member here since 2006, so for almost 10 years. I moved here from San Diego, and I was in San Diego for almost a year. And then before that, I lived in Cambridge, Massachusetts for 5 years. Before that, I lived in Berkeley, California for 5 years as a grad student. And I am not teaching this quarter, and I will be teaching the next 2 quarters. I'm teaching a course on Sage in the spring, which you may want to take. And I don't know. Any questions?
What time is that course going to be?
I don't think it's been scheduled yet, but probably in the afternoon, like 1:30 or 2:30 or something.
I'm going to talk to you about that so it doesn't conflict with the course. I'd like to go to that.
Okay. Excellent. Okay. All right. So what is SMC? So basically, it solves the problem. You want to have a collaborative web-based way of using mathematics software in teaching a course, or in being a student in a course, or being involved in a workshop, or doing research. So that's the problem that I made Sage Math Cloud to solve, mainly because the course I just mentioned, which I taught several times in the past, is extremely hard to teach when students have to install Sage on their computers. And installing Sage has only got harder and harder and harder over time, right, and LaTeX and so on. In fact, right now, if you take the latest current version of Windows, Linux, or OS X, the only one of the three where you can install Sage natively, or you're not using a virtual machine or something, is Linux. It doesn't work on OS X, and it doesn't work on Windows, which is really terrible. OS X kind of snuck up on us. They had this recent release of El Capitan, which introduced all kinds of surprising security changes.
It broke the tech path also.
It broke every, pretty much all open source software is completely broken now on OS X. So it's pretty exciting and really disturbing. So that's a big problem. And the kind of topics I wanted to teach in the course were, you know, some Python, some LaTeX, so like very nice typesetting of mathematical formulas, and of course Sage. And having that all in an easy to use place was the motivation. But then there's a lot of things where you want to see what the person's doing. So you assign the student some homework, and they're working on it, and they get stuck. And how can they ask you for help easily? So it's not very good if they have to run up to you at their laptop in class and kind of show you something they're doing. It'd be nice if they could just send you a link, you open it, and you can help them out immediately. And also just like giving them assignments and getting them back and so on can be tedious. You can use Canvas and upload the files there, but then they have to copy the files out of Canvas and upload them into their own copy of Sage somehow. And that just gets, I mean, there's steps. And then they'll end up they'll have to name the file somehow with their name in it. And everybody will do that differently. So you'll get go completely insane trying to grade. It's just stupid. So it's meant to solve that problem initially. And Sage Math Cloud, by the way, it's not... So I started Sage Math Cloud in 2013, but I had written with other people various web browser-based interfaces to Sage starting in 2006, actually, or 2007. I think it started getting good in 2007. So it's something I've been doing over and over again for quite a while. But this one's a lot better than I think the previous ones. And it was always motivated by students and stuff. There's a program at UW called SimUW, S-I-M-U-W, and it's a high school, it's for high school students. It's funded by, the person, but some rich local person who made a lot of money. People make a lot of money around here, who likes mathematics, and you may get involved in it, or have already been in it, or know somebody that's in it. In any case, I taught in it a whole bunch of times and developed a lot of the Sage Notebook, the predecessor to this, for those summer workshops. In any case, that's what it's motivated by, especially math software. However, a lot of people are using SMC now, or using it for things that have nothing to do with math. Just they want to do something involving Python or data analysis or R or like stats type stuff, and they want to do it collaboratively with other people. They're teaching a class that involves that sort of thing, so they use SMC. Or another example, there's a company in England called DataSift, and they basically mine data about what people are saying on Facebook. And they have a Python library, and they want to train their customers to use their Python library. And they do this training like all the time, every day almost. And they switched from trying to run a bunch of IPython notebook servers on Amazon to using SMC for that purpose. And there could easily be hundreds of other companies with similar needs. And they're one of the companies that pays us the most, so it's nice. What the problem that SMC really solves is basically collaborative web-based Linux. That's probably a better way of thinking about it. If you want to run Linux and you try to install on your laptop, it can be kind of painful. I don't know if anyone here runs Linux on their laptop. It's painful, right? I mean, maybe you've done it. It's just kind of painful. I've done it many times in my life, but the desktop environments and stuff are just, there's not really any clear focus, and so it gets really, really confusing and frustrating to try to use. Set up Linux for your grandma or your mom and then expect them to seriously use it. I did try that once with my grandma. really bad, really, really bad. So, and I mean, even if you're an expert, it's really painful to use Linux on the desktop. But with SMC, basically you get to use Linux through a web browser, and you get kind of a nice environment to edit files and work with other people, and secretly behind the scenes, everything is really just running Linux, but you don't have to really know much about Linux at all. You just get the value of all the server-side software that's been written through Linux. So that's a way to think about it. Just like on cell phones, not this one, but on Android phones, they're also running Linux. So in fact, the most popular deployed kind of consumer operating system in the world, I think, is Android, which is a version of Linux. It's a kind of very highly modified Linux. So in fact, people use Linux a lot in funny ways. And similarly, SMC is basically a way of making Linux very accessible to a lot of people. So you can think about it that way. But that's no way to, like, if you're trying to describe it to somebody in one sentence, you probably say something like Google Docs for math or something. That's not at all how it really feels, but that is kind of a way of conveying what SMC is. Okay, more stuff. It's open source. Everything, all the code you guys write will be open source. You can keep the copyright of anything you write. You don't have to assign it to the company or to me or the university. And the only requirement is that the license that you put on the code is GPL compatible. So it could be BSD, MIT license, but it has to be GPL compatible. Okay? So like if you do a whole bunch of work for pay or for credit or whatever as part of this project, then we'll use it, but you can also claim it as your own, have your own like project on GitHub. It can help with your job portfolio, whatever. So it's different than like an internship at almost any company, but they're going to own everything. Okay? And I think that's an important thing. And that was not how it started. Like when Nick and John worked on, and when you guys worked on SMC for the first over a year, it was closed source. And the university was kind of causing all kinds of trouble. But
thank you, NSF.
Yep. We, in the data management plan for one of the, for two of the grants that supported work on SMC, I had, kind of unbeknownst to me, put all code written supported by this grant will be released under the GPL. And I'd written that, the grant, all that stuff happened way before SMC started, but it was still supported, SMC was still supported by that grant, and the data management plan is legally binding on the university, and on me, and on students.
They didn't want it to be open source.
Yeah, they didn't want it to be. In fact, they had it like in their, they had SMC in their hands, but that extracted it, so. It wasn't really a choice, it was the way it had to be. But I'm actually very happy that it's open source. Okay, it started, I started writing it, I started playing around with ideas in 2012, based on things from many years before, but I actually started writing SMC in March 2013. I basically wrote the first version that people started using for a course that I was teaching starting in April 2013, the SAGE course that I mentioned before. And so I had a really, really scary version that was written during the SAGE days in Portland, and instead of going to it, I just sat down for a week and spent my time very wisely. Like every hour of the day, I kind of just planned it so I could get this thing done in time for the course, and I didn't sleep very much and was just careful with my time. Got something out there, ran it entirely on the desktop of my office, and people used it for the course. And it went pretty well, but of course there were lots of issues, and there's still lots of issues. But today, for example, in Iceland, somebody ran a course with 250 people, a day-long workshop involving Python. 250 different people, and he, I asked him how it went, he said it worked extremely well. So it's a good sign. Things are scaling up pretty well. There's now a Delaware C Corporation. So SAGE is set up so that it can grow, get funding from people, have stock options, all that sort of stuff. So I founded that in February 2015. So that's kind of the structure. It's open source, starting in 2013. There's a company founded this year. And the audience, so there are many people that use it, but the primary audience really is students in courses and teachers of courses who will force their students to use SAGE MathCloud. So, and the goal really of my like basic goal is just to make it very easy for people to use SAGE. However, SMC has a lot of functionality that has nothing to do with SAGE at all, involving editing files in various languages, and all kinds of other stuff involving Python and so on and R. That was scary, a monitoring incident. So there's a lot that goes beyond just SAGE, but at least is sort of hopefully helping the usage of SAGE to grow somewhat. That's one of the main goals. Okay, here's a. I'll just give you a quick functionality, or a quick demo of functionality. Okay, we're in a project in Sage Math Cloud that we've been using for a long time. So I'll show you first. Here are my projects. I probably have more projects than most people. So I have, I guess, about 250 projects total. See, there are quite a few. And these are just the ones that are visible. There's also hidden projects that are right here. So these are related to courses and stuff. There's deleted projects. So far, we haven't really implemented deleting beyond if you try to delete something, it tags it as deleted and puts it in kind of like a folder. That's it. But there's no way to actually do anything beyond that. There's no like empty the trash. Just not implemented. Like the top priority is not to, constantly we're driven by, I'm very nervous actually to see that cloud monitoring alert thing popping up. Oh, it got resolved. Okay, good. So usually, very often, the decisions about what to do are based on making sure that it works tomorrow because there's a lot of people signing up. Like, in the last 24 hours, it's like 559 new accounts were created. And so if you have that many people sort of joining, a lot of the people that join actually use it because a very large number of people that sign up because a teacher in a class makes all their students sign up. So like you teaching a class, you made all 50 of your students sign up. Probably
it's closer to 60 because 10 people signed up and then dropped the course. So like 60.
Yeah. So the retention of those people are probably not just going to play around with it for 5 minutes and never come back. Like at least 50 of those 60 are going to be using it all quarter. There's just they have no choice. They'll fail and lose all quarters. So there are a lot of people that try it out and then don't come back. But they're right now the people that are signing up because it's a new academic year. A lot of them actually use SMC as a result, and then that puts a lot of load on the servers, and means that we have to prioritize. And so, for example, deleting projects forever isn't like the top priority for anybody at the moment. Actually, there's actually no way to delete an account right now except email me, just because again, that's like not the top priority. But once a month, somebody emails me and says, "Please delete my account," and I have a function I type on the command line to delete an account, which of course all it really does is mark that account as deleted. It does nothing for you. One thing, by the way, people don't work with sort of a lot of top secret data, so to speak, inside of Sage Math Cloud. It's almost always, people doing training, people doing stuff for courses. So the kind of data security issues that are a huge deal with certain types of platforms, like email, for example, are less of an issue for us, I think. And even companies, when they use it, they're usually using it for training purposes, not for actually working with really, really sensitive data. Okay, back to my, all right, so showing you projects. Just giving you a high-level overview, there's a help page, which just has a whole bunch of links to relevant things. It has a big link at the top, which says, email this address if you have any problems, don't hesitate, etc. So when people think about UI stuff to improve, you may want to think about ways to make that better. There's so many ways that this could be made better, but at least it's possible to find an email address to send an email to. There's a lot of websites you use where you're like, geez, I'd really like to just email somebody and have somebody respond pretty quickly, and it's hard to even find the email address you should send to. It's like hidden in the footer, and it's some email address that doesn't look serious. So at least it's pretty clear here, probably if you email this, you're going to get a response. This email address, we were using something called Zendesk, which is a kind of like a help support management program. So when you send an email to help@sagemath.com, it automatically gets put in, a ticket gets created in Zendesk. And then all the people who have accounts on Zendesk with us, all the people are me and Harold Chili right now. But hopefully one of you will want to do support at some point in the near future. And then you'll also see these support tickets. We all know about the support ticket, and then we can work on it, and you'll see, this is what it looks like for us. Let's see if this works. So, here's recently updated tickets. So you see that each of the tickets is here. It's kind of like email, but it keeps track of status a little bit better, and you can assign tickets to people. Everybody sees what everybody else does. You can search it, and so on. And it also keeps statistics like... here, these are the statistics about the number of tickets, things like how long it takes us to respond. So our average Our step, okay. I guess we're not doing the satisfaction reading. That would be very bad. So. I don't think we sent out that survey ever, so. It's kind of disturbing. So average first reply time. So it's 2.3 hours for us. 28 hours is, I guess, their average. So that's probably good, et cetera. So they have industry average and us. And then I guess people can ask for support via Facebook. I don't know if that ever happens. But also, mainly it's via email. That's how it's set up right now. Okay, so I was just pointing that out. Back to the help. There's a bunch of other things here, which I won't go into any detail about now. There's an interesting plot right here that gets updated frequently called current usage. This tells how many separate browser windows are connected to SMC right now, so it's 591, and how many projects had some file edited in the project in the last 5 minutes. So with the graphic, like, for example, this project I'm using right now for the demonstration would not count as part of these 82 because I didn't actually change anything in the last 5 minutes. So that means that there's quite a bit of activity. This gets updated automatically frequently. And there's also other statistics about projects modified in the last day, week, and month, which give you a sense of how big it is. And for example, the projects in the last day, in August, at the beginning of August, that number was often around 1,000, and now it's at around 4,000 because of the new academic year. It's never been around 4,000 before, ever. Okay, there's also like legal stuff, terms of service, pricing. I didn't make those up. They were all created by a law firm in consultation with me. They are, I don't know, they're expensive, but they're serious. Okay, so that's help. Okay, let me show you the connection thing in the upper right. This tells you your ping time to the server and which hub you're connected to. Currently, there are 9 separate web servers on the back end, that you could, one of which you'll be connected to. These are Node.js processes that sit there and run, and you get a persistent connection between the browser and that process. There's one of 9 of them that you'll connect to, and that's which one you're connected to. Okay, there's account settings. This is a bunch of configuration stuff about your account. You can link your account to various things. You can change font sizes, keyword bindings. There's lots of options for how the editor works by default. One bad thing is that all of these options, like strip channeling whitespace, they apply across the board no matter what type of file you're editing, which doesn't really make very much sense because some types of files you would want this for and sometimes you wouldn't want it for. And so there are some things that need to be reorganized. There's a newly added feature, which is user profiles. So you can have like a little picture using Gravatar, you can choose a color if you don't choose a picture. And this will appear if multiple people are editing a file or if there's a chat, then you'll see like their little face in the chat or you'll see their face at the top of the file when they're also actively editing it. And it fades away over about 10 minutes. Okay. So there's lots of stuff like that in account settings. There's billing stuff for entering your credit card. These are subscriptions and invoices and stuff like that. And there's also upgrades. So if you're a paying Sage Math Cloud customer, you'll see a screen like this under upgrades. It shows what upgrades you purchased and then how you've applied them to various projects. So this just shows the total amount to which I've applied them. And then down here, it shows which projects I applied them to and what I actually applied.
It looks like a bug that it lists these two projects given that there's nothing applied there.
These two shouldn't be listed. Yeah, I think it's checking whether something's defined or not, and there's zeros.
So that's not good. Okay, so that's settings. And now once you get inside of a project, like the project we're looking at, there's a file manager.
So this lists, so what is a project? A project is a Linux account on a server on Google Compute Engine. Okay, that's what a project is. The interesting thing about a project is you can have a whole bunch of collaborators on the same project, and these are listed under settings. And you can see that in this particular project, we have various collaborators. All of these people can open this project and then edit files in the project, do all kinds of, basically they have equal rights as far as what they can do with this project. And they're all, these are different, well, obviously these two are not different people, they're the same person with two different accounts. But they're, you know, different accounts, but they're all using exactly the same Linux account when they use this project. And if you have many different projects, then you can have like a whole bunch of different Linux accounts that you're using with various people. So it's a very different model than you might have seen before. Yes?
I have a quick question. You know how you can subscribe to upgrade your computing power?
Yes.
If, like, let's say a teacher is, like, responsible for, like, teaching a course, if, sure, and if he bought the subscription, like,
yes,
the best one, and then he gets all his students to collaborate on it.
Yes.
So if he's the one that hosts it, does that mean, like, all the other students get the benefit of the subscription when they're not actually paying for a subscription?
Yes. Although, let me clarify, there's two different answers to that question. One, if he adds all of the students in the class to a single project as collaborators, then the properties of that one project are what everybody gets. It's like everybody's connecting and using that one Linux account together. And so like if the total CPU is two cores because he upgraded it, together the grand total that they'll be able to use, if everybody runs stuff all at once, is still two cores. It's not like everybody gets two cores. Okay, that's the first thing. The second thing is, if you actually open if you're going to run a course, what you do is you create a course file. It's if you click on plus new, one of the things you can do here is manage a course. When you click that button, it creates a file, and in the file you can add various students, and then there's a settings part of the file. Each time you add a student, by the way, it creates another project for that student. So I will illustrate that. Sure. So here's the project that you start with. This is a teacher's project. And then the teacher, inside of their project, creates a file, which is a course. It's kind of a course management system, kind of like a catalyst that's sort of built inside of Sage MathPod. Other than that, today I looked at what catalyst is. When they add students to the course, for each student that they add, a new project is created. So student A gets their own completely separate project, student B gets their project, and these projects are on a whole bunch of different computers all over the place. So if you have 50 students in your course, there'll be 50 additional projects created, one for each of those students, 50 Linux accounts. And when you open the course, there's a little, in the settings panel for the course itself, there's a way to allocate the quota stuff that you've purchased uniformly across all of these projects. For example, if you've purchased 5 cores and there's like 17 projects here, you can make it so that each of these will get like made the math complicated. If you purchase 17 cores and there's 17 projects here, you can make it easily so that each one of these gets one core and upgrade. And you can add a little bit of disk space to all of them, and add something at a time out. And you can move them all from the free servers to members-only servers by clicking the checkbox. Okay, so that'll clarify. Yeah. Okay, so again, a project is a Linux account on a server somewhere, and these are the files in there. This is just a kind of web-based representation of some files in, let me open the command line. This is a command line. And if I type ls, it's just a bash terminal, it'll show exactly the same file that I was looking at before. If I type ls-l, you'll even see them with like file sizes. And the login name of the user that was created associated to this project is just the project ID, which is a randomly generated version 4 UID with the dashes removed. So if you look in settings for the project, there's a project ID right here. And if you take the dashes out, that gives you the username for the project. You can also just directly SSH to any project. If you click on this button, SSH into your project, which Nick recently added, it will show you how to SSH into your project. You have to set up SSH keys. So you edit a file and add your SSH public key to that file. And then once you've done that, you can SSH into the project. And you just use this name. So I will maybe illustrate that. I don't know if I have SSH keys set up yet, but if I type that, we'll see what happens.
looks like the host name changed. Okay, and it worked. Okay, so I'm now logged into the project, but using SSH. The files we're looking at here are exactly the same as the ones we were looking at before. And you can use SSH, any tool that's built around SSH. For example, there are plugins for editors that let you edit a file locally, and then whenever you save it, it gets copied via SSH to some remote machine. So that's a possibility here. So basically, whenever you create a SageMath Cloud project, what you're creating is an account on a virtual private server, if you want. And it's just a full Linux account. Like, you know, like probably CS department gives their students Linux accounts. So this is just like that, except every time you click new project, like 2 seconds later, you suddenly have a brand new Linux account. And it's on a machine that has lots of other Linux accounts, but you can't see that. They're hidden. We're just seeing all of my processes. Until about 2 or 3 days ago, you could see all the processes of every user on the machine, but now they're hidden, and you can only see your own processes. There's additional levels of sandboxing that are happening. Okay. All right, so that's what a project is. And using the file manager, like the talk I'm giving right now, here is the raw source. I clicked on the file. Okay, so that's the file listing. You can sort of navigate around. We've rewritten the way this listing looks many times, and we're totally not happy with it at all. So if you look at it and you hate it, then it's okay. This is a page for making a new file. You name your file right here, and then you can click one of these buttons. Because I've zoomed in, or because of the resolution, it looks kind of funny. That's what it usually looks like. So you click one of these buttons, and you'll create either a LaTeX document, a Sage worksheet, a Jupyter notebook. You can manage a course. You can make a new folder. You can make a to-do list. You can download a if you put in a URL of something on the internet, you can click this button, and it'll download that file into your project. And you can also create a chat room if you want to chat with people. Okay. And you can also drag and drop files and they'll land right here. Again, this could be improved in many ways. Also, and there's one additional thing. There's lots of other types of files you can edit. Like if you want to work on Java code, nothing stops you from just creating a Java file. You can in fact just name the file right here, anything you want, and you'll get an editor. And it supports syntax highlighting and auto indentation and stuff for like 60 different languages. Okay, whenever you do things in your project, like, I don't know, change the title of the project, create a new file, open a file, delete a file, move a file, whatever, then it gets entered in this log. So it looks like Nick just changed the title of the project. For a long time, we didn't log anything except opening a file, and so people were always changing the name of this project and never knew who was doing that. But now we know. So you just changed it. If they did something like, so if you notice down here, there's chat. Let's say you really quickly want to open that chat file. So you can type chat up here and it will show you just the chat files, which is nice. You can click on any of these and it opens the corresponding file. So here's the chat that we had there. And here's the history of the chat. These things are all files, so terminals, chat rooms, courses, every single thing is just a file. And you can look at it, like you can open it on the command line with VI or something or Emacs and actually look at the file. Like let's take this chat. You don't have to know about any of that, but you can if you want to. So if I go into the directory work and then go VI 2015-10-08 Sage chat, each of the chat messages is just a single line in JSON format. So,
what does a course look like?
It's just very similar to this. It's just a bunch of JSON. It's one single file with a whole bunch of lines that are JSON. And you can actually just look at it, edit it. Watch this. So in the chat it says, I added a new field. I'll change that to, I added an awesome new field. So I'll write the file. Now if we go over to the chat, it will hopefully notice that I made that change automatically. I might have to, not sure if it'll, I'm surprised it isn't updating to indicate that change.
I think I did save it, yeah. Let me make sure that it's changed. Yeah. I think it didn't re-render the past, which is really sad. Let me see if at least... Okay.
It seems stupid that I had to open and close it. I should not have to do that. I think it is implemented that way as an optimization because we don't have any support inside of the chat for editing past messages right now. So I probably, in order to make it fast in case there's like hundreds of chats, made it so it doesn't, once it's rendered something, it assumes that it isn't going to change. And so there's probably like a should component update thing that I've just set to always return false once it's been rendered once. So that's probably why it didn't update. In any case, for other file types, if you change them with the command line and save them, it will notice that and then update the first one. Nick is changing the color. So like in account settings, he's changing the color. And you could also change his name, and it would change very quickly. Almost everything in SageMath Cloud is set up so that when you make changes, they propagate to everybody else almost instantly. So like he's actually just like changing his name in account settings and it almost instantly updates in that tooltip, which is pretty cool, I think. And like if you were to put a picture, it would change quickly and stuff like that. Okay. Your random gravatar. Okay, so that's the log, and there's a lot of stuff there. So there's, I guess, 48 pages of stuff in the log. So that says 48. Typically what you want to do, typical way you use the log is somebody did something and you kind of want to open the same file because you're working in a group. So you just kind of type their name or look at the log and you can click on something and open the same thing that they just opened. Or you know in the last couple of days you opened a certain file, so you just find it in the log and click on it. Okay, there's find. What this does is it just allows you to do like a full text search of the files in the project. There's settings. This lets you change the... What is that? You put a funny Unicode character. Cool. Growth.
That's a lot of languages.
Okay. So, yeah, it does Unicode. So there's the title and description of the project. You can change these at will at any moment. It doesn't break anything to change the title because the URL is this long, ugly UUID, which is fixed. And instead of the title being part of the URL, the title is just something you can change whenever you want. This control, you can do things like stop the project. You can force the project to save to, I haven't really defined save very well yet, but what that does behind the scenes when you click the save button is it saves all the files in the project from the project, which remember is a Linux account on some machine, to another machine where snapshots are created. It's a completely separate machine. So I'll get to that in a minute, but projects have a snapshot facility. So if you mess up the files in a project, you can easily see what they were like 5 minutes ago. And clicking save forces it to sync the files from your project to the remote snapshot machine, basically. It's something you'd rarely have to use unless, for example, you're hosting, if you just want to make sure that there's a remote copy of your files right now, you can click that button. I mean, the motivation of that is mainly my wife's website is a SageMath Cloud project, and it's also hosted on some remote server, and in order for her to update her website, she has to make sure it saves the files. It'll automatically save every 5 minutes if you're editing files, but often she wants to refresh and see that the changes got made instantly, so that's why there's a save button right now. But it'll probably matter more in the long run. These are the quotas that projects have right now. These are mostly a feature of what sort of parameters you can control with Linux C groups, which I'll just write the word here, C groups. These are secretly kind of behind the scenes. So one of the main features of the Linux kernel that's relatively recent, and if you've ever heard of Docker, have you guys heard of Docker? No? Okay, cool. It's not the super trendy buzzword I thought. But in any case, some people are really into something called Docker. And C groups, here's the point of C groups. So it used to be, if you were like a sysadmin for a department and you had a bunch of people using your computer, then you might have one user who would start a whole bunch of processes at once, and they would use up all the CPU on the computer. It would be really annoying for the other person who starts one process. And so, like, what C groups let you do is say, all processes of a given user, the totals of all of them will, they can use at most one CPU. And you can then, you can basically make it so, like, all the processes of one user are treated together with uniform limitations. So it's super useful if you're, say, going to run 200 different people on the same computer and they're all actively using that computer. You can, with C groups, you can easily make it so that if 200 people are simultaneously using the computer and they all try really hard to launch lots of processes, the amount of CPU they get is equally and fairly shared between them. So that's the sort of thing that's really nice. You don't get that one person, just because they're running 10 times as many processes as another person, gets 10 times as much as the CPU. Okay. Okay, so that's the settings. And then the only other thing in my tour that I wanted to tell you about is the different types of files. And let me look back here. So I'll choose like two to show you, but there's a whole bunch of different ones. So I'll briefly tell you about these and then just choose like two to show you a demo of. Sage Worksheets let you use Sage inside of SMC. So you can type mathematics and you get output. Sage is a absolutely massive piece of software for doing mathematics, but you can think of it, if you know about Python, it's basically Python with a whole bunch of functions pre-imported into the Python environment for doing things like symbolic integration and working with matrices and computing determinants and drawing 3D plots and kind of all this kind of stuff you do in Mathematica or MATLAB or something. So that's what Sage is. Jupyter Notebooks, so that's a notebook interface that's very popular in the sciences for interactively working with Python and R and Julia and many other languages, and they're nicely supported in SMC as well. LaTeX is a language for writing high-quality typeset mathematical documents that are typically published as PDF files. Probably 99% of math research papers and a very large proportion of physics research papers are written using LaTeX. So it's like the industry standard for writing something that looks really professional. It's very, very different than Microsoft Word. It's like the completely opposite spectrum. And it looks way, way better for writing mathematics, but it's way harder in some ways than Word. It's way easier in other ways. For example, cross-referencing and sections and all the numbering and bibliographies and stuff are actually really, really easy in LaTeX. It's just sort of built in to the language, and it all automatically updates nicely. LaTeX also scales really well to hundreds and hundreds of pages, in some ways at least. The terminal, so I showed you that. That's the command line terminal, which often when you use a remote Linux server in the cloud, you just get the terminal. In SMC, you get a terminal, and you can change the color scheme really easily. You can have multiple people that open the same terminal all at once, and they'll see what each other are typing, etc. See you later. There's a file manager, as I mentioned, collaboration, there's chat rooms. I've shown you most of these things. So I'll show you quickly Sage Worksheets, Jupyter Notebooks, and then I'll stop showing you this very long 20-minute demo, which is turning into like 45 minutes. Okay, so Sage Worksheets. Here is a Sage Worksheet, and I'll also start a Jupyter Notebook. Okay, so here's a Sage Worksheet. You can do amazing things like compute 2 plus 3, 5. All right. You can also... there's lots of examples of things to do up here, like let's compute a symbolic integral. And there you are. You can, if you type show, it will display the result in a more easier way to look at. You can draw plots, like let's plot a function, so x times sine of x. There's a lot of options that you can pass to the plot function. They are similar to the options that you would pass in Mathematica. Why is this so slow? That's weird.
Okay.
So this is a plot. By default, it produces an SVG graphic, so you can right-click on it and save it. You can also save it in many other formats, like PDF, PNG, etc.
You can change lots of parameters. Like if you wanted this to be purple and very thick, and you wanted grid lines, you just kind of say that, and then you just I hit shift or I hit Alt Enter, and then it reevaluated that cell. You can click in the middle and include new cells. And here's an example of a 3D plot. So how about a 3D implicit plot? Okay. So what this does is it draws everywhere that P is equal to 0 using 3JS, which uses WebGL. And it's interactive. You can like drag it around. You can zoom in and out. There's opacity, et cetera. And the code, by the way, that does the implicit 3D plotting was written by a UW freshman during the summer, like right after he was done with being a freshman, named Bill Calchoice. He's like, I need a project involving Sage, and my brother writes video games. So I'm like, 3D graphics. And so then he wrote this, something called the Marching Cubes algorithm. And it's the same code that's being used here. And there's tons and tons of other stuff related to the documentation is like probably 8,000 pages at this point. So there's a huge amount of functionality related to all areas of math. And that's just the core Sage library. And there's lots of other stuff that we install into Sage, like NumPy and SciPy and all kinds of extra packages, scikits for machine learning, etc. And of course, it's Python, so there's like 40,000 other packages that are available. And you can use them all from here. Jupyter is very similar. You can also do 2 plus 3, and you get 5. It's snappier, which is annoying. I need to make Sage worksheets just as snappy. Let's see. I don't know. That won't work because I'm not using the Sage kernel, but you can actually change the kernel. There's a whole bunch of different kernels that are available. Python 2, you can use Python 3, you can use R. If you change the R kernel, then the entire notebook is an R notebook instead of a Sage notebook, instead of a Python notebook. You can use Sage instead of just pure Python, and that like sets up the environment to do plots, and so that little like special Sage-isms like 1.10 will work. Anaconda is a distribution of Python with lots of scientific stuff pre-installed, so you can select that, etc. Okay, and everything here, so lots of little features that are, I think, really nice. So for example, if we go back to the Sage worksheet, there's a little history button, which is kind of hidden due to my zoom level, but I revealed it. If you click on this, it'll show the document you've been working with, but there's a little slider across the top. And as you drag it, you can change. So we started looking at the worksheet at 5:22 when it was empty. And then if you move it forward, you can see what state it was in at 5:23. And now 3 minutes later, it's like this. So remember, we made that change, then we did the 3D plot, et cetera. So the complete history of what you're doing with almost any of the types of documents in SageMath Cloud is recorded this way. And John wrote this functionality, not this last summer, but the summer before. And the same is true even for IPython notebooks, although it works a little bit differently there. But you can see that we can go back and forth in time and revert to specific versions and so on this way. So this is often really nice, because when you're messing around with these kind of interactive documents, it's really easy to lose something that you did that worked. And with this history, you can go back really easily and see what the thing is that you had before.
So if you continue editing from something before, but it...
Yep. In here, it's a read-only thing that you can slide back and forth. You can't actually change anything here. In IPython, currently, it says, any changes you make to revisions displayed below will be discarded. So it doesn't switch to read-only mode as you drag the slider. You know, it would be really nice if it did, but I had not implemented that. But perhaps you will. Okay, so that's it for the demo. And let me zoom in. Oh, wait, I'm going to switch to the worksheet, actually, which is right here. Oh, by the way, in the upper right, one thing I didn't mention, there's a little bell. I noticed there's a little one in there. So something exciting happens. There's a notification. If you click on the bell, depending, what you'll see is, first, for every single file you've ever edited, there'll be an entry in this list, which is kind of bad because I've edited a lot of different files. And so it's starting to get really long for me. There's 1,361. There's supposed to be a function where it will truncate it after some point in time, but I haven't implemented that yet. I've been putting that off. But it's starting to become really important.
has starting to get really slow to load this. It won't be for you because you probably haven't been using it that long, but it's actually any file on any project that anybody has touched that you're a collaborator on will be listed here in order by the last person that edited the file. And you can search it. So if you want to see like all the terminals, all the .term files in any project that I'm a collaborator on, that's what you see here. Okay. If somebody chats, so they type a message in a chat room, or they type a chat on a file, like on a Sage worksheet, and I didn't show you that, but like these worksheets, there's a little chat on the side, so you can type messages there. This chat is really old, it hasn't been updated in a long time, so it's not as good as the chat room chat, but in any case, there's a chat. For any file, there's a chat associated to it. The chat you can use, it's full HTML, Markdown, LaTeX. You can use all that when you're typing your chat messages. But whenever a chat happens, by somebody else, you'll get a number for that. That's the only thing that causes these notifications to appear, is when there's a chat. Okay. So for chat rooms, by the way, I think the feature we added most recently is emoticons. So you can actually type like that, and it'll give you a happy face. Or like, it's a little inconsistent, but there's another one you can do for my wife. A couple of things like that. Okay, so yeah, so that's why. Whoa, what? Hey. Huh. Okay, so that's the demo functionality. All right, so. Quick remark about traction. The next thing I want to tell you about is that SageMath Cloud is growing. There's a page you can get to if you click on Help, and then go down here called Historical Usage Data. So it's kind of buried, but it has a whole bunch of plots, and one of them shows the number of projects modified in the last 24 hours, and there's like this rolling median. And so this green line is an indication of how many people are using SageMath Cloud. It's not exactly the same thing. But on a daily basis. So notice that it's a little bit over 4,000 right now. And if you look 1 year ago, so it's October 8th, so a little bit into October, exactly a year ago, it was just over 1,000, maybe 1,500. And I don't know, the previous October isn't here, but it wasn't very many, maybe like 400 or 500 the previous October. And so it's, you know, more than doubling from 1 year to the next. And this growth is kind of fast. In that, so there's an interesting point right here. At this point right here, all of SageMath Cloud was hosted on about 20 computers at University of Washington. And then I realized that I needed to move SageMath Cloud out of University of Washington. And especially when I read some of the rules about how things work here. Like, for example, all data of everybody could just be like freedom of information request acted by people and I don't know, they have a lot of rules, it's really crazy. In any case, I moved it out and then it didn't work very well when I moved it to Google because I went from something that more or less costed the equivalent of $15,000 a month to hosting it for about $2,000 a month. And I tried to squish a lot of usage into much less computers and it sort of broke and rapidly decreased in usage.
It was also near the end of the
school. And it was near the end of the school year. So it was a combination of the two. I think this is sort of, everything got fixed by about this time and then there was the usual decline. And this entire decline is just because the academic year is over and summer, our main market is students and classes, which there aren't a lot of classes in the summer. And then the new quarter started, and then slash new semester, and then it's gone up a lot. And we have no idea if this line is going to go up here.
It's off the charts.
It's going to go off the chart. It's going to suddenly stop right here. But it's probably going to continue growing like it's growing right now until Thanksgiving, where there'll be a little dip, and then Christmas, and it'll go. So. I mean, it's pretty likely that's what will happen, and then it'll go up again really quickly in January. And we have to be ready, so it'll be a lot. But January, it could be late. It's hard to say. So it's growing quickly. There's many other charts here that indicate growth, but it's getting used a lot. This is an interesting one. This is the number of new accounts per day and per week. So up here is around 2,500 new accounts last week. This is like so far this week, it's this number. And this is per day, number of new accounts per day. So it's usually around 400 to 500. per day during the week.
Okay, another sort of metric is active users. So here, this is Google Analytics active users for their last month, and it has the daily active users and the weekly active users. So you can see that weekly active users is around 11,000. So of course, these numbers are very, very tiny compared to, I don't know, the RuneScape wiki numbers that you showed me. The RuneScape's a very popular game. So. But yeah, at least it was 10 years ago. But given the, it's growing quickly, and so this could get very big. It could be that in a couple of years, there'll be millions of people using it every week. Okay, so that's that. So there's a lot of traction right now. We'll see where it goes. Okay, I'm going to give you a super high-level view of the architecture with a little, I don't know, ASCII art diagram. I haven't drawn a proper diagram of the architecture. If anybody likes to draw nice-looking, that looks really bad, though. Jeez. I'll show you the real ASCII here. There, it's probably a little better because of the... Okay, so here is the architecture. These are web browsers, and they connect primarily via WebSocket connection, though we do have fallbacks in case there's no WebSocket support for the browser, to, right now there are three different, even though there are four in the picture, there's actually three HA proxy servers. So these turn the SSL encrypted connection into a non-encrypted connection, and they also load balance across various hubs. There's nine of these hubs. The hub is a Node.js program. It sits there running. It typically will have about 100 separate clients connected to it. And the hubs talk to a database called RethinkDB, which is it's a somewhat different database than than all other databases, because it pushes results in real time to the person that connects to it. So instead of doing a query, you like do a query once for a certain thing, and then you subscribe to anytime that query changes, you get a push notification that the result of the query changed. So that's how RethinkDB works. I'll say a lot more about that at some point in the future. But there's a bunch of RethinkDB servers running, and I don't know, earlier this week, the whole site sort of crashed and burned and completely stopped working at about 10 o'clock on Tuesday. And the reason was that the database had, the number of queries that we were making to the database just at about 11 a.m. just exceeded the capacity of the database. It's like this threshold. Everything's going fine. You're like at 98% capacity, 99. Suddenly you hit a threshold, and suddenly nothing's responding at all. Like, you suddenly go from responding to all the requests to responding to almost nothing. And more people keep showing up and refreshing, and it just gets worse and worse, and then the whole site just dies. And so that happened, and I had to, during the peak traffic of almost 800 people, I just put up a message saying it's down, and I took all the database nodes and quadrupled their capacity. And then I just started the site back up. It took 20 minutes to do in the cloud. And when I did that, suddenly everything worked perfectly and has worked perfectly since. So in any case, that the threshold of capacity currently, I know what it is because I hit it, and it was very painful. The hubs then, so users connect to these hubs, and then the hubs connect to a whole bunch of machines on which actual compute happens. That's where your project is. That's where your Linux account is. For each project, there's a Linux account, and the hubs will kind of relay all the messages back and forth. So like as you're editing a file, as you're typing in the terminal, you type a letter here, and it goes through HA proxy to the hub. The hub then sends it to the right compute machine, and then the letter gets typed, and then somebody else types something, and it goes to the compute machine, and then it goes back. So what's that? Looks like me.
Oh,
no. Who is that?
It's the guy in Norway.
Oh, hi, guy in Norway. It's Jackson?
Jackson.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Great. Okay, so that's the, just to summarize the architecture, these are the most important components in technology. So if you work on SMC, you're likely to learn a lot about some of these, okay? And they are React.js, which is what most of the front-end client code is written in, but we want to have all of it written using React, and currently
I would say 50% of it's written in React, and a super, super, super high priority is that the other 50% get written in React. Because the other 50% right now is written in jQuery spaghetti code.
Oh, yes.
Yep. It's really not as good as what it could be. And React is really, really nice. RethinkDB, as I just mentioned before. Node.js, which is what these hub servers are written in. Node.js, if you don't know, is JavaScript that you run on the server. It's a, and it's highly, it's very, very good at doing hundreds of things at once, but not literally at once. Like it does, it lets you handle I/O coming in from hundreds of different clients and sends I/O out to hundreds of different connections, all almost simultaneously. But what it does is it kind of does a little bit of each one. And what has one single thread, and it does a little bit of each one, one by one. So it's very clever and very fast. And because JavaScript got super, super fast as a result of Google and their V8 project, Node.js itself is also very, very fast for what it does. So we use it. Another thing is Sage. I'm just using the raw markdown for some reason. So Sage is used a lot for, you know, serious math stuff behind the scenes. Sage is written in Python and Cython and the other languages, but it's very Python involved. And then Jupyter is this other web-based interface to Python that we also use a lot. And LaTeX, as I mentioned before. But as far as the Sage Math Cloud itself, these three things are super, super important. Okay, some resources for development and discussion. So the project that I'm giving this talk from right now is right here. And I think John should probably add everybody to that project as collaborators.
Yeah.
Then you'll be able to see all of these chats. You'll be able to chat yourself, et cetera. We have information about various development servers that are located there with complete installs of Sage Math Cloud on them, which are useful if you want to do development on Sage Math Cloud. So it's here. We have a Slack thing set up. Slack doesn't ever seem, seems like Harold's the only one that ever uses Slack. But,
who's Harold?
So Harold is in Austria. He's been working on Sage since about 2007. I think he's been a grad student since about 2007 or something. And he works full-time on Sage Math Cloud now. So I hired him like 2 or 3 weeks ago to work full-time on Sage Math Cloud. It's really great. What happens is like I fall asleep and then he wakes up. And so we tag team all the keeping the servers running, doing support requests, etc. The time zone separation is perfect. He's also extremely good technically. He knows all, so I'm a number theorist and I do like pure math research. That's my sort of research area. His researches and interests are much more in data science type stuff and statistics, so it's kind of nicely complementary to what I know about. And so he set up a lot of this stuff. He's doing a lot of work on the core of Sage Math Cloud, and like if I'm not available, he's likely to be available, again, because of the time zone difference, as he's in Austria. Okay. Gitter, this is something that's a competitor to Slack that's very tied to GitHub, and this is used a lot more by people. So here's what it looks like. People chat about Sage Math Cloud here. It's totally public. Anyone with a GitHub account can instantly start chatting here. And various things get hooked in. So a lot of people will be signed into this. It's kind of like IRC, but in a web browser.
We had a big argument about Slack.
So, you get... what was the conclusion?
One guy really liked it, and I said it sucked, and that was the argument.
So what I think we should do mostly is use Sage Math Cloud's own chat rooms, despite them possibly being the worst of all possible things to use, because of the dog feeding aspect. So that's what I think we should use. So here's an example. Whoa, pizza. Okay, are you hungry? Is somebody saying they're hungry? But you can use these, you'll get notifications. You can put markdown and HTML in them. One thing I added 2 days ago, because of all the dog fooding, is if you take any link, like, I don't know, you're looking at a history file right here, you can paste it into the chat like that, and you'll get a link, and it'll work. If you click it, it opens it directly right inside of Sage Math Cloud. It doesn't like refresh your whole page or open it in another tab or anything. It just opens it in the tab in here. And so all the links, if you post in an external link, it'll pop it up in a new tab. If you post in any link internal to Sage Math Cloud, it'll properly open it. If it's in a different project, it'll open that project automatically.
So for example, let's see, if you have access, of course. So, all right, here's a terminal that's in a completely different project, and I'm gonna paste it into the chat, my terminal. And notice inside of SageMath Cloud, in this particular copy of SageMath Cloud that I'm running, this is not open yet. But when I click on it, it'll open that project and then open that terminal inside of that project. Okay? So there's some advantages regarding integration of SageMath Cloud's chat into SageMath Cloud. And by the way, the development of SageMath Cloud is, like, SageMath Cloud is entirely written, almost entirely written from within SageMath Cloud, which is nice as well. Like when you're editing files, you can see other cursors of other people and stuff like that. Or at least, it may not be nice, but it forces us to make it better. So, okay, so back to our story. There's Zendesk, so for doing support. Right now there's two of us that do that, but I hope very much that some of you will, in the future, help with support. A lot of the questions are like, how do I do this little thing in Sage, or whatever, or like Linux questions sometimes, or how do I install something? Okay, a good thing to finish with, here's just kind of an overview of the sorts of things that you might do. Slightly more details than you might already have, or less. So answer questions and link to public stuff. So what I mean by that is, you could literally like just sit down and try to answer questions on Stack Overflow and other places that maybe involve Sage or something, or Python. And in SageMath Cloud, you can make a file public so that anyone who clicks on the link can then see that file. So by default, all projects are private. Everything you do is private. But if you go over here and click on boom, share, then you can make something public. And then you get a URL that you can then share that will link back to SageMath Cloud. So so that would be one thing to do. Of course, so for example, just an example of this, somebody asked some question on Stack Overflow like 2 years ago, and I think Harold made a link to a public worksheet and gave an answer, and then that was, what did you say, that was like one of the top...
Well, it wasn't even that popular. It got like 5 upvotes, but it got about 5,000 people to visit the site, and resulted in about 250 people signing.
So you could literally just like answer one question on Stack Overflow, and over the next 3 years, it could lead to tens of thousands of people visiting SageMath Cloud and possibly signing up.
And oh, it's also growing, by the way. Like you can see the graph of how many people clicked it over time.
So that's something you could do. And it's just like, I mean, you don't have to do any programming at all to do that. You just have to find a question that you think a nice answer would sit in SageMath Cloud, and then put it, then create like a worksheet or something that illustrates the answer, and then make a link. In the course of doing that, I think you'll become frustrated in some ways with the functionality of publishing things in SageMath Cloud, and that will result in some ideas for front-end people to make the publishing functionality better. So there's a huge amount of room for improving how to publish stuff from SageMath Cloud, how to make it public, I mean. Another thing, there are many books and articles and tutorials and stuff where there's a whole bunch of Jupyter notebooks, these like IPython and Jupyter are synonyms. There are a whole bunch of notebooks, and it would be nice to take those collections of notebooks when legally allowed and create a SageMath Cloud project that has all those notebooks in it and just test to make sure everything works, and then tell the author of the book or whatever that, hey, one way that a person could use all the Jupyter notebooks for your book is just make a SageMath Cloud account and then go to this link, click a button, and then they'll have all the worksheets and it'll all work there and they can just get going. They don't have to install anything or whatever. So that could also lead to a lot of people using SageMath Cloud that wouldn't otherwise use it. There are thousands of Sage notebooks. Sage Notebook was something like Sage Worksheets, but from a couple of years ago. There are thousands of these Sage notebooks. We automated the conversion of them to Sage Worksheets. They're sitting in a project called Sage NB, one of the projects on SMC. They're just sitting there. Somebody could go through them and make sure they work with the current version of Sage, and then make them public again, maybe advertise them in various places, or index them, at least the good ones. So people used to make really nice content with the old Sage notebook from 2008, 2009, 2010, and publish it. And sort of all got kind of lost when I had to turn that off. And also, Sage has changed over the years, so some of these won't work, so it will take some work in order to fix them so that they work with the latest version of Sage.
There's also a large number of interacts. So these are interactive worksheets that people have created.
If we look at this link, you can see what they look like. They're really fun. You have all these little buttons you can push, and you can see fractals and stuff as a result. So so just to give you an example of what this sort of looks like, look, here's a fractal binomial measure, whatever that is, and this is what the picture looks like. You can actually use it right here by clicking evaluate, maybe. Yeah, so here it is live. You can drag the slider. But it would be nice to have like maybe all of these interacts also available as worksheets in a Sage Math Cloud project. So anyone can easily go in and modify them and use them that way. And as you can see, there's quite a lot of stuff that's available there. Some of them work, probably some of them don't work, etc. So it'd be nice to have a way of, you know, testing them to make sure they do work, updating them so they all work in Sage Math Cloud, etc. Maybe improving them. Just an idea for something where you could get going very quickly and start doing something. We have a GitHub issue tracker for Sage Math Cloud. I'll add a link to it right here. So it's GitHub. So it's just so there's 131 open issues right now. And since you all have access to this file soon, there's the link. So if you look at it, let's see. Okay, here's an example of one of the issues. Create an export to SWS feature for Sage Worksheets. So Sage Worksheets, there are like a certain format file. It's a text file. SWS is the old Sage Worksheet format. So the idea here would be to make a Python script that converts from one format to the other. In any case, there's a lot of issues, some of which would be really, really, really hard, some of which might be really easy. But you can look through these issues. So here's one, add a Haskell Jupyter kernel. Probably if you just Googled those words, there would be instructions for how to do that. If you could just tell me exactly what to do in order to add a Haskell Jupyter kernel, then in Jupyter, when you see the drop-down list of R and Julia and all these other languages, we can add Haskell as another one of the languages. And it's probably pretty easy. It would be nice to have that. So that's really kind of a Linux thing, where you just figure out how to do that with Jupyter and Linux, explain it to New York Herald, and then we'll make sure it happens in the live server. So there's lots and lots of stuff here. But people have pretty much every issue here is something actual people have asked for, possibly repeatedly. But it can be useful to look at that. Analyze data about SMC. There's a ridiculous amount of information that could possibly be analyzed about SMC. Like every file that anyone edits, and in fact, almost every state of that file, because of the history feature, is there, just sitting there. Sitting there right now, waiting to be analyzed. Like, what sort of mistakes do people make when they try to use Sage? Why do they get error messages? What command are they mistyping frequently? And many other questions. Just thinking of questions to ask would be good to do. SMC, the whole situation is completely different than before SMC when developing Sage, because you could actually look and see what functions people use in practice and how often they use them, and how they use them, and how long they take when they use them, and stuff like that. So I don't know what questions to ask, but there's a lot of questions that could be asked. Finishing the front-end rewrite, already talked about that. There's some stuff relating to billing and plans, so commercialization stuff that there's one big, extremely high-priority feature that hasn't been implemented yet, which is very much needed, which is to make it so that if you teach a course, then all the students in the course can pay directly rather than the instructor having to pay. Because it turns out, if you look at the world, there's a whole bunch of different models for how people can pay for Sage Math Cloud when using it in a course. And it turns out you kind of have to implement all of them. And at some universities, doing one thing is a good idea, and the other things are all considered horrible, unethical, and wrong, and you can never possibly do them. And at other universities, it's the exact opposite. And there's like, it's really weird how that is, but like at UW, I think you guys have probably used WebAssign before, maybe in a class, and you guys had to pay. Like you had to take your credit card out and pay WebAssign directly. Some places, many places in the world consider that just wrong and unethical, and there's no way they'd ever let that happen. Other places, that's the only possible way that services can be made, like that services get paid for at all. And therefore, you have to kind of implement models for doing many of these different things. And I now have like very concrete places that have both situations. So more has to be done there. So something I've been talking a lot with John about is
new algorithm for doing real-time sync. So I don't know, maybe Nick, could you open this file and, I don't know, edit something? Because I keep saying real-time sync, but I haven't actually shown a demo of that at all. It's the .md file. Yep, see that little, we now know that these two people opened the file, Nick and Jackson Brown in Norway, and now you can see their cursors at the bottom, and now they're typing stuff. So this is real-time sync, that's what I call it at least, because as you type, you can see what other people are typing. And often people say it's what Google Docs does, or whatever, but I mean, it's a little weird to me because Google Docs is around for years and years before it supported this. Like, when Google bought Google Docs from the company that really made Google Docs, it didn't do any of this, and then they added it on years and years later. But in any case, that's famously a system that does do this sort of thing. You can see there's little cursors. If you look at the cursors carefully, you won't like them very much, like how they get on top of each other and how that works. There's things to be fixed. But also the actual way that real-time sync works, if you have a really bad network connection, as we discovered at the last Sage Days, then it doesn't work very well, and bad things will happen. There's ways to rewrite it. I came up with a different algorithm for doing sync, which I've implemented a kind of proof of concept of, and I need to roll it out more systematically to all of SageMath Cloud and make it sort of back all the editing of files, which is kind of terrifying. So that's what sync is about. SMC itself, we put very, very little effort into making it easy to use. Mainly the model is the following. You get an instructor like Jayav, who is here, who knows how to use Sage, right? And they figure out how to use SageMath Cloud enough so that they can explain it to the students in their class just enough so that they can use it to do assignments and play around with the things that are relevant to their class. But SMC itself, it doesn't really have much in the way of tutorials or like little like tours integrated into it. There's no help button here at all, nothing explaining Markdown really. There's a million ways in which it can be made more user-friendly. And we've done very little along those lines. And basically, when I've looked at like how people use SageMath Cloud, the random person that signs up that isn't signing up because they're going to be taught how to use it in the context of a class will try like crazy random stuff that makes absolutely no sense and to give up. For example, they'll open a Markdown file, type 2+2, and it doesn't give them 4, and then they'll think it's broken and give up. So stuff like that. Or they'll try to, they'll like the first thing they'll do is they'll go here, go to the terminal, and type 2+2. And they see command not found, and they're like, oh no, it's broken. Or worse, they'll type Sage right here. Which, this is a term, this lets you enter one command, it runs the command, gets the result, and shows you the answer. It's kind of like just a quick little terminal. If you type Sage, it's running an interactive program, and it never returns. So it times out after 10 seconds after trying to run Sage. So that's just dumb. I mean, this should be a lot clearer. Maybe if you type Sage there, it would actually open a Sage worksheet or something. I don't know, or a terminal running Sage. And every time, like, at least when certain types of errors pop up, they get sent to the back end and put in a database. And, like, sometimes you can sit there and just look at all the errors people are seeing, and that's pretty disturbing. So, but it's an extremely good way of, we can add some JavaScript based on the current version of SMC. And every time certain types of errors appear, like this error, other errors, we can have it send a message, and then you could just sit down and look at a day's worth of those errors. And that's a really good way of figuring out like the top priority things as far as what to make more user-friendly. There's other things that confuse people, like, you know, you can't drag and drop files at all. That's, like, if you want to move this file into that directory, you might think, oh, I can just drag and drop it. Just, like, nothing happens. That's kind of annoying. 2 years ago, you could actually drag and drop it, but now you can't. And maybe in 2 months, you will. So that's another way to make things more user-friendly. And I think Jackson in Norway, presumably, has lots of ideas for how to make things more user-friendly. Yep, two thumbs up. Another thing is we have this ridiculously bad landing page that you'll see if you go to sagemath.com. Sorry, Harold, but it's ridiculously bad. So Harold made it in a few hours, like based on some template from Iran, and then I fixed it a little bit so I could stand it in like 2 more hours. And that's what it is.
Oh,
but
it doesn't have the pictures anymore?
It does, look. See?
Oh, man.
Look, it has that picture, which is
picture
stock
Paul
photo
Paul,
from Wikipedia.
Like,
yep, it has those.
Are you still skating over elliptic curves or something?
I think I might have deleted that, because that was too
No, it's still there. Like, doesn't even make sense. So, like, this page, somebody wants to take this page and delete it, replace it by a better page. That's it'll be great because it's really not very good. Also, if you want to experiment with, isomorphic React, so server-side rendering of React stuff, this might be a nice page to do that on because, you know, you can just start from scratch and do something cleanly. If you want to try a different React framework or something like Redux or whatever, I don't know. Just,
also,
this is not very good. And it's not very useful either, so that's
not
helpful.
The SageMath Cloud Lighting page, like the actual...
Oh, yeah, that's another one, which is bad, too. And that's probably more relevant. So that's just the page you see when you go to cloud.sagemath.com. I made it a little better. I put little boxes around the meaningless buzzwords that only makes a lot of sense if you're a mathematician or, So it's all like, instead of telling you what you could do, here, for example, it just says you can use R and Octave and NumPy, SciPy, and Macaulay 2, and Singular, and LaTeX. And I'm sure that really means a lot to random visitors on the internet. Probably not. It's very technical and not really that useful as far as explaining what, saying that you can use SageMath, IPython, LaTeX, and terminals, maybe you should say something like, you can do mathematics and typeset and type beautiful papers and collaborate with people on data.
And then I can show you.
Yeah, and have like a pictures of doing those things.
That was one of the main things I would like to see, the examples, like example projects, we would have like just have maybe 3 or 5 or 10 little icons with projects. It's like, this is writing a paper, this is writing a book, this is teaching a class.
Yep. So it's not very, the landing page could be, this is really aimed at sort of like somebody who's been using Linux for years, for example. That's really the target of the page right now. And that's a small subset of the visitors, and it's not very useful to miss visitors. So there could be something that's much, much more useful than this.
Okay.
Yes?
So I've seen like the cloud, SageMath Cloud, this site, and the actual like Sage website.
Yes, SageMath.org.
The landing page that you showed me, the crappy one, I've never ran into that one before.
Good.
Yeah,
you've seen
this
one.
This one and the one that
it's just SageMath.com.
Which is
what's
not
the point
really
of that?
It's not linked from anywhere.
Nope.
What's the point of that page?
I think it exists because what is the point of that page? The point of that page, though, here's the point of that page. So it would be a quick-to-load page that tells you about SageMath.com, the company, and the SageMath Cloud product. Basically, it tells you it should be the landing page for the company and its main product or products. So it should have a link to SageMath.org. It should say what the point of the company is. It should say that here's this thing called SageMath Cloud. When you go to cloud.sagemath.com, it actually loads like 2 megabytes of JavaScript and other stuff total. Maybe not quite 2 megabytes, but it loads quite a bit of stuff. Whereas sagemath.com, that could be a site that loads it's just a few kilobytes, and it loads very quickly. It's very lightweight. And then it has links to other things. So that's the idea. But maybe, I don't know. It's worth discussing at length. I do not know what the right thing to do is. Maybe there should be no sagemath.com. Maybe it should just redirect to cloud.sagemath.com. It should. I totally don't know.
So when you load this page, it loads megabytes of JavaScript.
Yep.
Just this page.
Yep.
Well, because it's a single page.
We could change that. It's a single page application. So when you load this page, it loads absolutely everything needed for editing the Sage worksheets, it's a single page application. This is loading the complete thing. Using Webpack or something, we can make it dynamically load only the things it needs for this page and load other stuff later. So we could re-architect it so that the lightweight thing I just mentioned is pointless, because obviously you don't need everything just to do the sign-in, creating an account. But yeah, already, at this point, it's already loaded everything. So like the help page, that's why, clicking on help, it really is instantaneous. So I disconnected from the internet now. I can click on account or help, and it moves between the pages because they're already loaded. Yeah, SageMath Cloud, by the way, is a single page application. So you load it once, it loads all the JavaScript and everything necessary to run, and then all communication after that is via a single WebSocket connection between the browser and the backend web server. And so like just lots of JSON messages go back and forth ever more. So it's kind of a modern way of making applications, where you kind of you think of the thing running in the web browser as a program that's running there, and it communicates with the backend server to enhance its functionality, like to do serious math calculations that you don't want to run in the browser. Okay, and I think, let's see, right here. So, okay, landing page. Another thing is related to Linux, for example, is installing open source software and getting links back to SMC. To give you an example of this, today somebody was repeatedly in every possible way requesting that I install a program called GAP3, which I never used. But there's a program called GAP, and it's a computer algebra system for groups and programming. Group stands for groups, algorithms, and programming. It does group theory. It's been around since the 80s. And they had version 3, and then they decided to do a version 4, which was dramatically different than version 3. It's kind of like going from Python 2 to Python 3, where they massively broke backwards compatibility. This is a similar situation, but in math software. And so there's lots of packages and programs that only work with GAP3. So somebody was like desperately wanted to use it in Sage Math Cloud. And so I installed it today. I figured out how to install it. I installed it, so it's now available in all projects. Anybody can just type GAP3 in the terminal, and you're running GAP3. And then I wrote back to the person and said, it's there, and he's all excited. And then I posted on Twitter and a few other places that GAP3 is now in Sage Math Cloud, and asked that there's a website where you can download GAP3. So now I'm trying to get it so that there's a link from that website to Sage Math Cloud. Somebody goes to that website, maybe they want to go to Sage Math Cloud and use it there instead. There are probably 10,000 interesting Linux programs that would make sense to have running in Sage Math Cloud, for which there could be a link from that program to Sage Math Cloud. A person goes to a site for Posi Widget View, and they're confronted with two choices. Set up Linux somewhere, figure out how to install that weird program into Linux, or whatever it runs on, or click on the link that goes to Sage Math Cloud and use it there. And so this is like something you can replicate over and over again. It can result in a lot of traffic and users in Sage Math Cloud. It also provides a lot of value because it just makes it easier for people to use certain software, like GAP3. Maybe you have no idea what this is, but if you ever ran into something that would run in GAP3, a very, very easy way to do it would be just, basically it's either you install Linux somewhere and then install this into that and then run into problems, or you just make a Sage Math Cloud project and you're using it in seconds. And so Sage Math Cloud already has like probably 1,000 different things like that, but it can have a lot more. And some of them are really easy. This one is surprisingly easy. Some of them are actually quite hard. There are really big programs that involve like partial differential equations and numerical methods with them that people desperately want to easily be able to run in SMC, and I just haven't had the time to figure out how to get them to build and work. And so that would be a good thing for somebody to work on. If you like just tackling, build something good to work in Ubuntu 15.04 or soon 15.10. Sage Math Cloud is Ubuntu. Right now it's 15.04. Soon it will be 15.10. And the way all the SMC stuff gets installed is there's like a Python program that installs a lot of things. There's a whole bunch of stuff I copy and paste and then change when it breaks. It could be automated. We could use Ansible or Chef or one of those automated system installation programs to automate a lot of that. So a completely sort of there's a file called build.py, which I can show you what it looks like. It basically has a big comment at the top. So here it is. It has a big comment at the top. It's a Python program, but it has a huge comment, which is how to install various things. Like, here's the instructions for installing GAP3, by the way. You paste all of this code into the command line, and then you edit this file and set GAP directory to that, in that file. That's the install instructions right now. So if when I set up Ubuntu 15.10, I'm going to have to paste this line into the terminal, and that will download and install GAP3, and I'm going to manually edit a file, and then it'll work. It would be better, though, to use standard, there's more standard techniques for automating this sort of thing. Harold Chili set up some Ansible playbooks that are meant to do this sort of thing. It does like one thing so far, does almost nothing. But somebody that's interested in like automating testing and making Linux configuration work well could work on this project, which would be taking some of the stuff in build.py and making it more automated and testable. Like also GAP3, like maybe in 2 months I upgrade some package or some like system library
on Ubuntu, and suddenly GAP3 doesn't even start up anymore. I wouldn't even know unless the user tells me. So somebody could write a program that would go through and ensure that, at least do some sort of testing that each of the things that have been installed actually continue to work. So there's a huge amount of room for improvement regarding the quality of the system overall that could be made by what I just mentioned. Okay? So if you like, and like you could do a lot of it just by getting a machine running Linux somewhere and then trying to make all this stuff automated. Okay, so that's it. That's everything that I intended to say from 4:30 to 6:30. And done. Okay. I'm hoping we can meet at least weekly here to kind of do status reports and catch up with where we are. And hopefully have other coding sprints. Like, some of you live with John, right?
Yeah.
I don't know. Is there like a living room there? Maybe we can
have
coding occasional coding sprints at your house or here. I have this room reserved from 4:30 to 6:30 every Thursday for the rest of time. So so we have this as well, which is a useful room to have, I think.
John has a question.
Yes?
It's on the screen.
Will the meetings always be this time?
It's 2:30 for him, but like,
isn't that good?
It's way past 2:30.
No, 2:30 a.m. Oh. 3:10 a.m. Ooh. We will have meetings, but we can screencast record them or broadcast them somehow. Yeah.
Is this place not available at 3?
No. I wish.
That's like throughout the rest of the quarter.
Yep. We can work on getting a different room that's available earlier.
Okay,
but we can't do that until like 2 or 3 weeks into the quarter.
I could look for something in CSE also.
Okay. But basically 2 or 3 weeks after the quarter starts, it's easier to get rooms as a faculty person, and it's really hard at the beginning because normal classes have priority. So he's awake at 6 p.m. So you want to have a meeting?
No, he's saying now.
Oh, okay.
6 p.m. here, which is
I don't know. I mean, what if he's like always up late at night?
He's not me.
Okay. Like for you, it'd be more convenient, right?
So and then Tuesdays you have three faculty meetings.
No, there are occasional faculty meetings in the afternoon on Tuesdays.
Yeah.
And in the morning there's other meetings. There's a lot of meetings.
Okay, and mornings.
So Tuesday's pretty bad for me. Definitely any time on Thursday works for me.
Okay.
And we have this room at 4:30. Everybody's made it today.
Yeah.
But
John,
we can,
one of the guys.
Oh, but we can move it earlier, but we'll have to wait, I think, 2 weeks, unless you can get something in CSE. So,
yeah, I think we can.
Yeah. Okay, good. Let's see. Other things are keep track of what you're doing when you do stuff related to this. Because, for example, if you keep track of when you're working on things related to this, it's a lot easier to justify it for credit for the people who are taking the reading course. And then for a payment, you need to keep track of your hours because it's done by timesheets through UW. I think it's also extremely useful if people... So just to give you an example, if you look at this directory work, then you can see that there are a whole bunch of chats here. So what Harold and I do, let's just take a random thing, so October 3rd. So the second we start working on stuff, apparently didn't do very much that day. It's kind of embarrassing. Okay, October 1st. So basically each time we start doing something, we just type what we're doing. So you can see that we typed a lot of stuff. So he's talking about working on the Ansible playbooks. He wrote a log parser. He's running that and testing it. There's little links in here that you can click on.
So do you make a new chat room every day?
Yep, we make a new chat file every day. And then just when you start working on stuff, you type what you're doing. And everybody will see that there's changes. So you just click on this and you'll see that there's a number there. And then you'll see the chat, and you can click on it. It'll be in yellow with a little chat icon next to it. And that will show you the latest one. And so then you can just see what other people are working on. I think that's useful, just for coordinating. Like you might say, I'm trying to answer a question on Stack Overflow. Put a link to it. And then other people can look and see what you're doing. Or I'm making this worksheet that illustrates blah, blah, blah. Or trying to fix this broken old worksheet. Or I'm working on rewriting the login screen using React, or this dialogue right here, like the connection. I'm trying to redo the connection thing using React. Right now, that's old jQuery stuff. So you could say, I'm trying to redo that. Here's where I'm working. You just type that. And then we'll know.
I mean, it's really important to know what everybody's doing. It gets really confusing. So I think that is a good minimal thing to do. And plus, it'll just provide a really good log of what you've actually done, because it's all time-stamped. And easily, we can easily write scripts to parse information out of that, because it's just a, these are just files in a directory, as I showed you before. So it's very, you can write a tool to parse these chat scripts. Okay? They have timestamps. They have who typed the chat.
Maybe you want to do like a quick overview of the development process?
Yep.
Or I guess we don't do that now. I can do it individually.
Well, no, we should do something. So some people it won't matter so much for because you're not necessarily developing. But here, I'll show you how development works. Closing everything. Okay, so there's a README file at the top here. And this explains that there are a couple of, so I created 6 virtual machines. They have a complete, each one of them has a complete install of Sage Math Cloud in it. And if you want to use one of them, I always use Dev0, but you could use any one of these. And so you make a remark that you're using it. And there's a serious gotcha today, which I haven't been able to resolve yet, but will soon. But in order to actually use the VM, let me close a lot of these tabs because it's kind of overwhelming. Closing all the tabs. So VMs cost money by the minute to run, and I didn't know when you guys would start actually using them, and therefore these dev machines that are mentioned there are off. Some of them are off. And so like you'd have to go in here and turn them on. And currently, John, I think, can turn them on.
Yeah.
And I can, and Harold can. But they will also turn off after 24 hours. So I am in the midst of writing a script that will automate the process of turning them back on. We can also switch them to just stay on all the time if people are actually using them a lot. They're preempt instances. These Dev1 through Dev5 are all preempt instances. That's something that Google has where it costs like 33% of the full rate, but they can turn off randomly at any time and will turn off after 24 hours. This is, by the way, these are all the virtual machines of Sage Math Cloud right here. So there's like admin machines, compute servers, database servers, web servers, and these development machines. Okay? So you would use one of the development machines. Let me show you. Dev0 is one that's up and running right now, which I've been working on actively a lot. So the files are remotely mounted from that development machine to this project. You could create another project and also remotely mount the files. That's discussed in here. So you can SSH to the machines. Let me just do that. So I'm going to SSH into one of these machines by typing dev0. The name of the machine is dev0, dev1, dev2, etc. The username in the machine is Salvis, as you can see right there. So once you connect into the machine, it's running Sage Math Cloud. Like if you look at PS, you can see that there's HA proxy servers running, there's Nginx web servers running, there's RethinkDB database servers running, a whole bunch of them. There's these hub servers. There's just a bunch of processes running on this computer. If I sort by memory, you can see them all on top. Actually, that's just pretty much all of them. So they're all running on one single computer. So Sage Math Cloud, for security and robustness reasons, it's designed so that you run like a lot of, you run various parts of the system on different computers, but you can run everything on one single computer. And that's what's happening here. There's also a virtual machine image, which I'm actually currently running on my laptop, right here. This is entirely on my laptop under VirtualBox. It also has a complete copy of Sage Math Cloud running in it. If I type top, you can see that all the processes are running here. So another possible way of doing Sage Math Cloud development is to use this VirtualBox image. And then everything runs locally and you connect to it locally on your computer. If somebody wanted to put some work into things, maybe it could mostly run under OS X or maybe even Windows, but I doubt it strongly, because RethinkDB doesn't run under Windows right now. Okay, so I've showed you one thing. Let me show you actually changing something and the result. Okay? So each of these machines, Dev 0 through Dev 5, there's a corresponding web server that's running. So if I do https://dev0.sagemath.com, I'll see the copy of SageMath Cloud that's being served from Dev 0. This is completely and totally separate from the main SageMath Cloud site. For example, if you click on help and look at the number of projects modified in the last month, is 28 rather than 28,000. Okay, so it's completely self-contained. And that's nice because if you want to go, hey, I really feel like making lots of ridiculous projects, it doesn't matter. It's just making these on this throwaway server. Okay. And you can open it up, you can do stuff. Let's make a change. So where it says auto save interval seconds, let's change it to say something else, okay? So I'm just gonna change this part of the site. So I'm gonna change some code that's written using React. So go back over here. I need to find the relevant code. So I'll go into dev0 salvis page. Inside of there, there's lots of code, so I'm just gonna do a full text search for autosave interval. Oops, that's the wrong place. I need to find, sorry. Okay, it looked through all the files. It found that there's a file called r_count.cjsx, and that contains this React code. And then inside of here, here's the thing that says autosave interval. Okay, so now I'm gonna change it. Let's change it to something else. Super quasi awesome autosave interval time. Okay, so I just change it to something else, save the result, and I happen to have, this is good. I have this thing running. Okay, I'm going to make a little change. Okay, so in order to compile the changes, there's a script that we wrote that does a huge amount of stuff. It detects whether you're in a development environment or a production environment, builds things completely differently in each environment. One environment takes less than a second to build everything and update it. The other takes 10 seconds and builds with completely different parameters. In order to use this really complicated script and have it automatically run whenever you make changes, you type W. That's all you have to do. It does everything automatically. It'll watch all the files. If anything changes, it automatically rebuilds. It takes about 1 second. When the change happens, you have to refresh to see the changes. Unfortunately, but that's the way it works. So if we go over here now and refresh, then we should see the changes, unless there was a big error as a result of what we did. So looking in here, it says super quasi awesome auto save interval. Okay. If we go back over here and make a change that's wrong, so I'll forget to put the quote there. Save it, and now it'll automatically run, and then there's an error message which tells us that it's wrong, and it tells us what file's wrong. And if we refreshed here, it would just show the same thing. It hasn't actually updated the site at all. Okay? But basically, you can do quite a bit of development now. You just, if we want to change this back, by the way, what you can do is click on history and find the relevant line 702. It's kind of nice. You can just sort of drag this slider and go back, see how it was supposed to be, and now easily change it back to how it was before. Go back over here. It is kind of annoying though, why do we have to go back and forth between two different pages? It should be there's a little way to immediately get the history right there at that line, have it appear in a little window that pops up on the side, and you can drag back and forth there. But that's not implemented. If somebody could come up with a good design and other people can implement it, that would be pretty cool. In any case, it's already still useful that you have the history there. It auto-saved. That caused this to run. There's no error in the output except for this error that I recently introduced. That has nothing to do with this. If we go back over here and refresh, we'll see the change, possibly. There's one reason why you might not see the change, which would be if your browser cached the previous version. And so you may have to disable caching or reload in such a way that it doesn't, I don't know, usually it pops something up there, but you could disable caching in some cases. That's basically the workflow for working on the front end, though. You edit files with this watch script running, watch to see if there's any errors, and then refresh the page. That's currently what we do. For working on the back end stuff, you have to edit other files and restart servers. So if you change Most of the backend is in two files, hub.coffee and rethink.coffee, which are right here. Rethink.coffee contains all the, basically everything that interacts with the database is in this file. And then hub.coffee, this is all the stuff that deals with users connecting and then the messages getting forwarded on. And there's one other file actually that's really relevant on the backend, which is compute.coffee. This manages projects. It starts projects, stops projects, saves the state of a project, just does a lot of stuff with projects. By the way, the language here, which if you want to work on Sage Math Cloud, you'll need to learn, is CoffeeScript, which is basically a preparser for JavaScript. It gets turned into JavaScript, but it looks a lot more like Ruby or Python.
It's like JavaScript without all the terrible,
yeah.
If you
take away all the semicolons and braces in JavaScript, then you more or less get CoffeeScript. And also, instead of having to type function, you put a little arrow to define functions.
It tries to do things in like the minimal amount of
characters. Like it's literally like the minimal possible characters for doing stuff for the most part. It does take some getting used to. We have a linter for it that will help ensure that style doesn't get all messed up. We also have Nick who will help ensure the style doesn't get all messed up. Because there are a lot of stylistic choices that you can make with CoffeeScript. If you haven't used it before, I would not assume at all that it makes any sense to you. You really want to look at, there's a page called CoffeeScript.org, I think. CoffeeScript.org. And by the way, CoffeeScript is kind of like to a mathematician, I'd say it's isomorphic to a subset of JavaScript. In the sense that it does not, there are many things you can do in JavaScript that you can't even do in CoffeeScript without escaping out of CoffeeScript. For example, in JavaScript, how many people here are familiar with JavaScript? Okay, good. In JavaScript, there's an operator called equals, the two equal signs, and it's insane, right? You never even want to use it. CoffeeScript just doesn't even have the double equals. If you type double equals in CoffeeScript, it's just always turned into triple equals, which is a much better operator in JavaScript. So this page is the CoffeeScript page, and you just, if you want to learn CoffeeScript, pretty much all you have to do is just read this one single page. Okay, it's one long page, and then there's the changelog. Yeah, like, it's this much of the page. And it's long, but it's a little language. By description, it's a little language. Pretty much each line in CoffeeScript just gets turned into a line in JavaScript. It's almost not quite one. Actually, usually a line in CoffeeScript gets turned into many lines in JavaScript. So an example right here. So if you want to make an object in CoffeeScript, you could say equals, and you say thing colon thing, string colon thing, string colon expression. This gets turned into this over here in CoffeeScript. So the braces are gone in CoffeeScript. In JavaScript, there are braces. The commas are gone. They're pretty much redundant. So you don't have commas. The word function isn't there anymore. Return isn't there anymore, etc. Like,
we can
people about this. And Nick and John are extremely good at CoffeeScript. Like, super, super experienced with it.
How does it handle multi-line?
You can use a backslash or parentheses in some cases. And if you... you can also, with indentation, it works extremely nicely, actually. So right here, let me just show you a little example in our talk. At the very bottom. Wow, this is getting really zoomed in. Okay, so this thing, I could actually go like that and indent it, and then I could have all kinds of things. So this is something, a equals 5 square a... And you can have a whole bunch of lines. It's like Python, and the indentation is significant. And so if you want to have a whole bunch of separate lines, they're all assigned to the thing on the left. You just indent the entire thing, and it works. So it's extremely minimal. CoffeeScript was getting super, super popular like 3 years ago, especially when I started Sage Math Cloud. I liked it because it, like in JavaScript, there are a whole bunch of really stupid things you can do to shoot yourself in the foot. And CoffeeScript just doesn't allow you to do those things, which is nice. It's very minimalistic, so you don't have to look at a lot of code. Like, just the number of lines of code is really small. Recently, the trendy thing is ECMAScript 6 or ECMAScript 2015 and so on, which introduces arrow functions into JavaScript. And CoffeeScript is maybe a little less trendy, but it's still extremely good language, and I like using it a lot, as do Nick and John. And so that's what we will use. And there's pretty good support for it inside of Sage Math Cloud, like auto indentation and syntax highlighting and stuff like that. And again, there's also a really useful site called JS2Coffee. Is it dot? JS2Coffee. Yeah, okay, JS2.coffee. And what you can do is type in any JavaScript over here and it auto-converts it to CoffeeScript. And so like if you find a snippet of JavaScript on the web, you can convert it that way. If you know how to do something in JavaScript and want to know how to do it in CoffeeScript, you can do this. I'm kind of curious what happens if you do A equals B. Huh. Oh, it flags it because there is not an equivalent way of doing it. Not supported. Okay, so that's good to know. So this is a useful site as well. Extremely useful. But there's, you know, you can of course search for tutorials, and it literally just pre-parses and turns everything into JavaScript. The main issue with that can be confusing is for debugging. If you're using a Chrome debugger or something, you look at an error that pops up, you'll see JavaScript code rather than CoffeeScript code. It's presumably possible to set things up with source maps, so you'll see the corresponding CoffeeScript, but in various situations, you'll end up looking at JavaScript code that was generated automatically from CoffeeScript. And this can be slightly annoying. However, it's not as annoying as you might think it would be, because it's usually pretty easy to figure out where. Like, if you saw that there was an error right here in this line, you could figure out that it corresponds to this in the CoffeeScript. And, like, all the order is the same. There's a pretty close correspondence. It's annoying, though, but it's manageable. But CoffeeScript is used a lot, and there's a lot of good tooling for it. Okay, all right, so that's an overview of development. There is still a big issue with the VMs not being on all the time, which, as I mentioned, John, for example, at any moment could just go to Google Compute Engine and click a button to turn them on. One other caveat to mention is that, let's see, I set up, where did I do it? So I set it up so that these URLs, like dev2.sagemath.com, map to that machine, but they actually don't work because the addresses, when I set that up, are ephemeral. They change. And Google charges you a lot of money if you assign a static IP address to a machine and then turn the machine off. And so you'll have to look in Google Compute Engine to see what the IP address is when you turn the machine on. This is all temporary. I will change it. But for like the next week, probably, I will not finish redoing everything. Although, if you guys are going to do a lot with actually use, like, if you decide I'm going to really use Dev1 and Dev2 a lot, I'll just assign static addresses and then switch them so that they're on all the time. So, I just don't want to leave them on all the time, having it cost a lot if people aren't going to use them. Okay? All right. One other thing, like, if you wanted to try to install Sage Math Cloud from scratch yourself, as I mentioned, it's open source. There's the top level of the Sage Math Cloud repo. There's a file in, like you would see this if you just go to the GitHub page called install.md, and this documents how to set up from scratch, on Linux at least, all of Sage Math Cloud. It's kind of complicated. As far as I know, nobody except me has ever done this, and I made this file when doing it. So, and like, so it might be difficult. It keeps going on and on and on.
Maybe.
But at least it's possible. Theory. I did it because I have a VM with it right here. Okay. All right. Any questions now?
Will we be working on the Chrome app and the Android app and other things as well?
Oh, yeah. I think that it would be really, really awesome to have like native Android and iOS apps that do stuff with Sage Math Cloud. So the model I have in mind for how that would work, which I really, really, really wish somebody would do something towards, is the following. So there's something called React Native, which I've never used, but it's really trendy right now and uses React. So we could share a lot of code with our existing React code that we've written. What it does is it lets you write purely in JavaScript or CoffeeScript a React application that runs natively on Android or iOS that uses all the native APIs. And it has like native, like it's not just a web view embedded inside of an app. There's no web view at all. It's really literally natively running. And Facebook uses this to implement Facebook on
iOS and Android natively. I don't know if you guys remember, but a couple of years ago there was this big controversy because Facebook was like a web page on iOS and Android, was a web page embedded inside of iOS and Android. And Mark Zuckerberg was like, this is too slow, this is crappy, we're going to switch to writing a native application. And it's sort of like, it was like really, really controversial because people have been working so hard to try to make it so that you can write good native good mobile web pages. And when they sort of decided to just throw away mobile websites for Facebook, it was, it was nerve-wracking to developers because it was sort of saying that you just could not write a good application as a web page, purely as a web page. But it turned out what they really ended up doing behind the scenes is developing React and React Native, which they used internally to implement the native version of Facebook on those platforms. They released React Native for Android about 2 or 3 weeks ago, is it, or a month ago? So it's extremely recent. And the version for iOS was released in, I think, March. So it's all this year, even though they developed it since 2011. So what I wish there was were a native application that maybe it does almost nothing at all, but what it would have inside of it would be all the JavaScript of the single page application, and it would set up a WebSocket connection between the native application running on your phone right here and the backend, and you could log in using your credentials on your phone, and then it sets up this persistent WebSocket connection, and then it has enough code here so that it can at least like tell you these are your projects and like do a few basic things, okay? And then from that we could build a lot of other functionality. Like we'd share some code with the main application, but a lot of it would be new that would be specialized to what you'd want to have on iOS or Android. Because the interface you'd want to have, like for clipping through projects, it would be completely different than probably on the website. So the very first thing would be to make the Hello World React native application in the platform of your choice, and then the second thing would be to try to get it to have the SageMath Cloud JavaScript code in it, and then the next thing would be to have that code actually connect to SageMath Cloud and log in, and then give you some information back using our internal like WebSocket-based API. Okay? I would imagine, if I were to try to do that, I would imagine that just what I described would take me probably 2 weeks of focused effort. So that's the kind of, don't be annoyed if it takes you more than a day to do something like that. But once that were done and such an application existed, then I think we could start building a lot of cool stuff on top of it. And at least you could check on, like right now I'm always using my phone to check basically like maybe 40 times today. I looked at my phone in order to see these two bars, okay? And every single time I did that, it took like a long time because I had to download 1 or 2 megabytes of JavaScript. And it doesn't cache it because on the phone there's so limited space. It just like throws it away and reloads it every time. Because it's just big enough, it doesn't cache it very well. And it would have been way, way better to have a single native installed application sitting there that uses the API to get these numbers and then draws a nice little graphic. And that would be like maybe the first thing to do. Just something that lets you, you don't even need to do login to do that. You just need to use the API to get the stats. Like all this information. And of course another thing would be listing projects, letting you like browse through your projects, seeing who your collaborators are, stuff like that. Seeing like the chat, like at least you can maybe see what files were modified. So have like a mobile version of this thing right here. That would be nice to do as well. I don't know much about a Chrome extension, but
do you have one?
There is a trivial Chrome extension, basically it's just a link to the website, and on some operating system, it lets you run SageMath Cloud in a way that doesn't intercept keyboard shortcuts. So there really isn't much there. So I don't know what to do there. But I don't know, who is interested in React Native or native application, mobile application development? You are? You guys are? You ever tried out React Native at all?
Yeah.
So it's very new, so there's probably a lot of rough edges, but really cool to be able to write something where it's mostly in JavaScript, or totally in JavaScript, but it still is super fast and native feeling. It has there's one thread that runs the JavaScript code, and then there's another thread that runs all the native stuff that Facebook built on top of Like they built basically Facebook built a native library for doing all the widget stuff on top that talks to React in an application that runs on the phone. So you get something that feels fully native, but actually you can use the same JavaScript code that you use on a web page and the same API. So it's pretty cool. And it works pretty well. Like the Facebook app on your phone probably works pretty well. People use it. A couple of people use it in the world. So it's very popular. Okay, other questions? Was it 6:38? I mean, another thing to do is to learn Sage. I think that's a useful thing to do. There's a Sage tutorial. You type Sage tutorial and look at that. So you might want to look at that. So be useful to know something about Sage in case you want to answer questions about Sage or you know, do some of those projects. Just looking, like, doing a search for projects that are open source that could possibly run inside of Sage Math Cloud and aren't there right now would be good to do, et cetera. And, I mean, the overall strategy here, I mean, the strategy right now is getting lots of classes using it, but a bigger additional long-term strategy is making it so that, like, anytime somebody wants to run open source Linux software that you can sort of reasonably run through a web-based interface, make it so it's easy to do that in Sage Math Cloud. Like, really, really easy. Like, within 20 or 30 seconds of them going to the site for the software, they're running it already in Sage Math Cloud. Everything's just kind of easy to get going with. I mean, you want to identify which software has the most... Maybe you could even look at, like, open source software and then look at rankings of the websites to see which ones are the most popular, and then think about which ones could actually run inside of Sage Math Cloud. One example is Jupyter Notebooks, Python. Another example is Sage. But there's probably lots of other programs that I don't even know about that could be running in here, could drive a lot of usage, etc. So, I don't know. Imagine the networked, highly technical, web-based operating system that people are using a lot in 2 years that saves them time. That could be what this might develop into, maybe. And then if there were there were bazillions of links back into Sage Math Cloud that let you get going quickly with programs, then that would drive a lot of usage. So. Okay. Any other questions? All right.